basically what I will try to do is I'll try to cover the natural key environmental issues in Sri Lanka during this 1 hour. If you look at the issue of environmental protection in Sri Lanka, can you hear me?
Yeah.
You find that the need for environmental safeguards is enshrined in the constitution of Sri Lanka itself. So if you look at the constitution and the article 27, it states that the state shall protect, preserve and improve the environment for the benefit of the community. And similarly, if you take article 28 of the constitution, it states that the exercise and enjoyment of rights and freedoms is inseparable from the performance of duties and obligations, and accordingly it is the duty of every person in Sri Lanka to protect nature and conserve its riches. So you can see both the state or the government as well as every single citizen of Sri Lanka has a duty to protect the environment. Now if you look at the laws about environment in Sri Lanka, you find that there's actually more than about 100 laws which have at least some provisions related to environmental protection in them. That doesn't mean that all these 100 laws are on environment. They may be on some other issue, but more than 100 laws have some kind of provisions relating to environmental protection. And if you look at some of the earliest environmental legislation, they date back almost to the last century, during the British period. For example, if you look at the law on forestry or protection of high elevation, those laws are more than 100 years old. Now the law that exclusively deals with the issue of environmental protection and management is the National Environmental Act of Act No. 47 of 1980. Now this is the law that really covers environmental management and protection in Sri Lanka in a comprehensive manner. Now there are several agencies that deal with environmental issues. You can think of the Coast Conservation Department, then you have the Marine Pollution Prevention Authority, or it's called the Marine, they have changed the name now to Marine Environmental Protection Agency, MEPA. Then you have the Sustainable Energy Authority, you have the Central Environmental Authority, Forest Department, Department of Wildlife Conservation. Then you also have a, in the Northwestern Provincial Council, there is a separate environmental agency for the only for the Northwestern Provincial Council only. So there are several agencies that are dealing with environmental protection in Sri Lanka. Now if you look at environmental issues, now most people, the minute you say environment, they think of green issues. Like for example, you would think of wildlife, forestry, biodiversity, etc. And now we all are engineers, so generally engineers have this view that environment means something green like forests and wildlife, etc. But you really find that actually environmental issues are, there's a lot of so-called brown issues in environment. What do you mean by brown issues really? For example, things like pollution, dealing with things like hazardous waste or water pollution, air pollution, all those things are called brown issues. And now more and more, what you find is that the green issues are left aside and the brown issues are taking over, because the pollution etc. is getting more and more. So actually the brown issues are taking prominence. Now if you look at the forestry and wildlife conservation departments, so between the forest department and the Department of Wildlife Conservation, they control almost 1.9 million hectares in the country between them. So you can see that the Wildlife Department and the Forest Department together controls a huge amount of land between the two agencies. So the forest department, the main function of the forest department is the conservation of forests and also biodiversity. The Department of Wildlife Conservation function is to protect the nation's indigenous fauna and flora. And also the Department of Wildlife Conservation is responsible for establishment of national reserves and sanctuaries also in the country. Now, if you take the Central Environmental Authority, actually the Central Environmental Authority is the agency that has been set up to implement the Central Environmental Authority is the agency that has been set up under the provisions of the National Environmental Act. So this act was actually passed only in 1980. So it's a relatively new law if you compare with other laws in the country. For example, if you take the forest ordinance, that's more than 100 years old. So you can see the National Environmental Act is a relatively new act. So the Central Environmental Authority was set up under the provisions of this National Environmental Act, and at the beginning the Central Environmental Authority was only a policy making and a coordinating body. It didn't have any regulatory powers. But later on in 1988, there were some amendments made to the National Environmental Act which transformed the Central Environmental Authority into what we call a regulatory agency with regulatory powers. Now, if you look at the major environmental issues in Sri Lanka, okay, these are the major environmental issues I have set up. Municipal solid waste management, that is waste management, especially in the urban areas. Then you have a problem of coastal erosion, especially in the southwest coast. You have water pollution coming mainly from sewerage, more than from industrial waste. Then you have air pollution, that is coming mainly from the vehicles and not from industries. Then you have certain amount of hazardous waste which has to be managed. Then inappropriate siting of industry. Industries are sited all over the place for creating a problem. Then you also have what you call the human elephant conflict, which you hear about a lot in the papers these days. Then soil erosion and deforestation. So these are the main environmental issues in Sri Lanka. Now, municipal solid waste management. So this is really a issue mainly in the urban areas. It's not a much of an issue in rural areas, but in urban areas like Colombo, it's a major issue. So even in cities where the collection is being done properly, the final disposal is always a problem. And you can see this problem even in Colombo, where the waste is actually collected. If you look at the city of Colombo, it's quite clean because the waste is collected regularly. But if you look at the place where they are disposing of that waste, it's really a huge big issue because there's a huge mountain of waste. You all must have read about Meethodamulla in Kolonnaa. There's always a problem, there's a political issue and people are protesting and all that. That is because all the waste that is collected from Colombo is taken to the Meethodamulla and just dumped, and there's a huge mountain there. So always in Sri Lanka, we don't really have what we have. In other countries, municipal solid waste is disposed of in what we call sanitary landfill sites. And if you visit one of these sanitary landfills in another country, you can't actually even say that there is waste there, because it's more like a park. They dump the waste, then they cover the waste, and then they grow, you know, beautiful flowers, etc. I have gone to one in Korea. You can't really, you don't get any smell at all. And it's actually like a beautiful park there. So in contrast, if you look at Sri Lanka, you can see these mountains of waste all over the place because they don't have any sanitary landfill sites in Sri Lanka. So the very first sanitary landfill site, this says will be opened in, actually this sanitary landfill site has been opened in Dompe now. It was run by the Pilisaru project, that is, that was implemented by the Central Environmental Authority. And this Pilisaru project, which was implemented by the CEA, has been assisting local authorities to set up composting plants all around the country. And around not 80, I think more than 100 actually, have set up this composting plant. And they also set up this first sanitary landfill site in Dompe. Now coming on to the problem of hazardous waste management, disposal of hazardous waste also is a problem in Sri Lanka. Now the Central Environmental Authority, they have a gazette notification saying what kind of waste streams are considered as hazardous waste. Now these hazardous waste can be industrial waste. Lot of industrial waste, they have a lot of chemicals, though they are considered as being hazardous. In addition, also hospital waste is considered as a hazardous waste. But if you look at the most of the hospitals in Sri Lanka, the way they dispose of their waste is totally unacceptable, because they don't have a proper method of disposing of their waste. So sometimes even things like needles, used needles, etc., they don't dispose of them properly, and sometimes the waste just goes with the municipal waste stream. So you can see how dangerous it is. Of course, it's not so bad as in India or some other countries, but still, for all, most of the hospitals, even in Colombo and Western Province, don't have a proper waste management system. And many of the hospitals, they don't treat their wastewater. And the solid waste, now you are supposed to separate the, you know, these used needles, and then infectious waste, even body parts. They just, some of the hospitals just bury them in their own land. Now even in the Maharagama Cancer Hospital, they use these radioactive materials. And some time back, even this radioactive material was being discharged into the paddy fields close by. So you can see it's a totally unacceptable situation as far as the hospitals are concerned. Then we come to the problem of inappropriate siting of industry. Now inappropriate siting of industries can result in pollution problems and as well as nuisance to people. If you look at the situation in Sri Lanka, this kind of nuisance problems are caused by mainly by small scale cottage industries. Because what happens is, many of these small cottage industries, they are started in a, you know, in a small house or something. And many of these places, I mean, they are in residential area. So the industry starts in a very small way, in a house. But as the business grows, their operations also grow, and then it becomes a huge problem for the other nearby residents. So this is a major issue, especially in the Western province. Because most of the industries in Sri Lanka, more than actually 80% of industries in Sri Lanka are situated within the Western province. And you can also see that the Western province is the most populated province in the country. So you can see that these small-scale industries can create a huge problem as far as pollution and nuisance is concerned. Now what has happened? I don't know, maybe somebody can help me. Wait. Okay. So, if you look at this siting of industry, there is a government policy that high polluting industries should be sited within industrial estates. So even though this policy is there, you find that there aren't sufficient industrial estates in the country. So this is why a lot of industries are situated outside industrial estates and causing problems. And even some of the industrial zones that we have do not have sufficient infrastructure such as waste treatment facility. Now if you look at some of even the BOI zones, sometimes they have waste treatment facilities not actually enough to cater to the industries within that zone. So these are some of the issues that are there with industries. Now coming on to water pollution, if you look at the pollution of water bodies in the country, it's usually from what we call non-point sources, or especially usually from sewerage rather than industrial waste. So you also find that some industries are discharging untreated waste into water bodies. For example, if you go outside the western province, find a lot of rubber factories which are discharging untreated wastewater into the nearby stream or a river, etc. But although people think that there is a lot of pollution due to chemicals in rivers, etc., actually it's not a very big problem in Sri Lanka as yet. The issue with sewerage, there is sewerage pollution or fecal pollution in most of the water bodies more than chemical pollution. Now if you look at, now there are some what we call common waste treatment plants that have been established in Moratu and Ratpalani and also in Ekalad and Jayala. So when you have these common waste treatment plants, these are areas where there are high concentrations of industries, Moratu and Ratpalani and also Ekalad and Jayala. There are a lot of industries. So what is happening is the wastewater from the industries is treated in the common waste treatment plant in these two places, and the industries have to pay the water board for treating their waste. So this is one way of actually tackling this problem of industrial wastewater. Now coming on to the issue of human elephant conflict, now this is an issue that you always read about nowadays in the newspaper, the conflict between humans and elephants. Now, why do you think that this issue has come up? Actually, this is mainly due to unplanned development. It's a major cause. For example, we have large-scale development projects built over elephant corridors. Of course, in Sri Lanka, wherever you go, you will find an elephant corridor, some wildlife reserve or a forest reserve. So it's a little bit difficult in Sri Lanka to do many of the development projects. Because as I told you earlier, most of the land in Sri Lanka is owned by either the forest department or the wildlife department. So wherever you go, if you are trying to do an irrigation project or a highway project, you always come across either elephant corridor or a sanctuary or a forest conservation forest or something like that. So this is why it's an issue in Sri Lanka. So what happens is when you have this big, very large development projects going on, it causes the elephants lose their, you know, the places where they used to live, and then they go into the villages, and there is naturally a conflict between the humans and the elephants. So this is not the fault of the elephants, of course, but it's mainly due to unplanned development. I was talking about the functions of the Central Environmental Authority. Now the CEA has focused its attention on two main regulatory functions. The first one is what we call the Environmental Impact Assessment process, and the second one is the Environmental Protection License of Waste Discharging Industry. So can somebody tell me what is environmental impact assessment? Have you all heard about it? How many people have heard about environmental impact assessment? Only one person. Two. Out of all these people, only two people have heard about the environmental impact assessment. That's really bad. And all of you are engineers. You have really never heard about the environmental impact assessment? process, even in your degree or something like that, you don't do about it. You do. Then there should be more hands up, no? So can you tell me what environmental impact assessment is? You have heard about it? Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, you know what. So basically, yeah, before you do a project, you have to have this report where you look at the potential impacts of this project on the environment. And then that report not only studies the impact of the project, you have to also say how you are going to mitigate those problems when you are when you are implementing this project. So environmental impact assessment is one of the most powerful tools in order to operationalize the concept of what we call sustainable development. And all major infrastructure projects as well as major development projects now require an EIA prior to implementation. So by doing this environmental impact assessment, you ensure that almost all the adverse impacts of the project will be mitigated. So this is really the purpose of a EIA. So what is the purpose of an EIA? The purpose of an EIA is to ensure that development plans or projects under consideration are environmentally sound and sustainable, and that environmental consequences are recognized and taken into account early in the project design. So the main thing here is that you look at the potential environmental issues from a project early in the project cycle. You don't wait till everything is planned and then sit down and see what is, how this project is going to be impacting on the environment. But this is actually what happens in Sri Lanka, because I have seen a lot of engineers, they design the whole project, especially in the government agencies. They go ahead and design all the project, and only later on they think about the EIA. So when they are designing the project, they have huge big reservoirs within conservation forests or national parks, because they haven't really looked at it at the beginning itself. So they are looking at it from an engineering point of view only and thinking what is the best way to design this project. But that is really not how you should do it. You should actually look at the impact of this project on the environment and also take that into account when you are designing that project. So you can't just simply look at the engineering aspects only and design the projects, because finally when it goes to implementation stage, either the forest department or the wildlife department or somebody will come and say you can't have this reservoir in this location, because they will say this is a protected area, we can't allow anything to be put here. So then you have to go back again and do that project all over again, design the project all over again. See, I have seen this happening so many times in so many projects in Sri Lanka, and that is because they are actually doing the EIA, but they are doing it for the purpose of getting approval from the CEA, not to actually look at the environmental impacts. So that is really not the purpose of an EIA, just to get through the CEA's approval. That is not the idea of an environmental impact assessment. In other countries, when you do an environmental impact assessment, they are really seriously looking at how to minimize the environmental impact of a project. In our country, EIA is done just to get, we want to get that CEA approval. Once you get that approval, you don't really even look at that approval. You just go ahead with the project. So that's normally the way that it's done in Sri Lanka. So that is not really the purpose of an EIA. Purpose of an EIA is to seriously study what are the impacts and to seriously take some action to minimize the impact. So if you look at the history of this environmental impact assessment in Sri Lanka, actually the legal provisions for environmental impact assessment were included first in the Coast Conservation Act, even before the National Environmental Act. So it was only 1988 that there were certain amendments done to the National Environmental Act, which brought in the EIA requirement for projects. So now this is a question that a lot of people ask, does every project require an EIA? So the answer to that is every project does not require an EIA, a full-scale EIA. So only what we call the so-called prescribed projects require an EIA. So what are these prescribed projects? If you want to know what kind of projects actually require this EIA, you have to look at this gazette notification. I have given the number here, which is dated 24/6/1993. So in that gazette notification, you can find out what kind of projects need environment impact assessment. So there are actually only a total of 31 projects in this gazette notification, which have been listed as requiring EIA. But in addition to that, of course, if even a very small project is situated in an area which is considered as being an environmentally sensitive area, then even if the project is a very small project, it has to undergo an environmental impact assessment. So now when we come to EIA decision making, there is a misconception in Sri Lanka that the EIA process is effective only if it results in the rejection of projects. So they think the EIA process will be effective only if you say no, you can't do this project. Lot of NGOs think so, at least. So the NGOs say that the EIA process is not effective because it hasn't rejected many projects. But the idea of EIA is not to reject projects. The only idea of environmental impact assessment is to make the projects better projects. So that is the main purpose of the environmental impact assessment process. Although there are some weaknesses in the EIA process, it has definitely resulted in the better planning of projects. Because during that EIA process, you look into many aspects that have not been looked at the initial stages. Now if you look at projects, most projects in Sri Lanka, most of them are politically driven. So they are not really driven by professionals, they are more politically driven. Some minister or somebody thinks, I want to do a project in my area, then he will do that. So because of this, there are many instances when even a proper feasibility studies are not done prior to the implementation of major projects. So in such instances, only when it comes to the EIA procedure, they even look at the feasibility of the project, because they haven't done a proper feasibility project, feasibility study at the earlier stages. Now I can give you some examples. I have personally seen this happening. People propose industrial estate where there isn't a drop of water anywhere in sight. I have seen this happening many times. No water at all, but they are proposing to put up industrial estate. So only when it comes to the environmental impact assessment stage, they suddenly wake up to see whether there is enough water for industries. And they find that there is no water source anywhere inside. So then it becomes a problem. Then there was a recent case where they were proposing to put the world's largest sulfuric acid factory right next to a Ranaviru housing project. Now, whoever thought of putting a huge big sulfuric acid factory right next to a Ranaviru housing project. Now this project actually came up for an environment impact assessment. So now we had to do the EIA and then reject the project. But actually, whoever selected that site should have actually looked at that site even before doing the EIA in the feasibility stage. They don't need a EIA to say if there's a Ranaviru, there's a house in there right next door to sulfuric acid. You can't, because sulfuric acid factory, there can be, there, it may continue without any problem, but there can be also an accident in a sulfuric acid factory, and what will happen if there is a sudden leak of sulfur dioxide or something. So this is why I say, they many times they don't even think of these basic things. Then even if you take the Veeravilai airport, even the Mattal airport they are criticizing. But if you look at the Veeravilai airport which was proposed before that, whoever proposed that, it was proposed in the middle of three bird sanctuaries. So three bird sanctuaries are surrounding the Veeravilai airport. So now whoever proposed that project should have actually looked at it and seen that, I mean, from the aspect, never mind about the birds, but even from the point of view of the airport and the airlines, there is a very high possibility of the airplane hitting a bird at some point of time, which can be really dangerous. So anyway, even that project went through the EIA process and then only it was rejected. Then only the project was taken to the Mattala area. Even Mattala, there are various allegations and saying that that's not the best site, but then Veeravilai was even worse. Then there was another project where someone wanted to bring what we call a shipbreaking industry. Now shipbreaking industry is one of the dirtiest kind of industries in the whole world actually. None of the countries want to have this shipbreaking industry anywhere near them. Now there were countries like Vietnam and Bangladesh who had shipbreaking industries, but even those countries are now going away from this industry because it's such a polluting industry. But in Sri Lanka, somebody actually wanted to bring a shipbreaking industry and put it in the Trincomalee Bay, which is one of the most sensitive bays in the, I mean, it's a very unique kind of bay even in the whole world. So then now all of these above projects should have been rejected long before the EIA process. Now all these projects that I have mentioned came up for EIA. So what I'm trying to say is, all these projects, if there was a proper feasibility study done, that should have shown that these projects are not really feasible in that particular location. But still for all, they came up for EIA. And it takes about 1 year for the EIA to go through. They spend a lot of money on doing the EIA, and then the EIA gets rejected. So this is a real problem actually in Sri Lanka, because nobody really does the proper feasibility studies for most projects. Of course, if they are foreign funded projects, the ADB or World Bank or something, then there will be some kind of feasibility done. Then when you look at the decision making process, even in the decision making process, a lot of government agencies don't make the decisions that they can make under their own laws, but they say we'll wait and see what the EIA says. Now those examples that I showed were mostly proposed by government agencies, and what I feel is that those agencies themselves could have taken the decision not to do those projects in those locations and not wait till the decision of the EIA, because if you wait for the decision of the EIA, it's going to take a long time and this can cost a lot in terms of money and time for the project proponent, as well as to the other agencies. So issues such as water availability of the project, siting issues, land issues, risk assessments, zoning issues, legal issues, they are all addressed to the EIA, whereas they should be addressed even independently before the EIA. As a result, the EIA process becomes the scapegoat. So the EIA process is, many people blame the EIA process for delaying projects, and they say that this EIA process is delaying the development development process of the country, because they say it takes too long for an EIA to be approved, and so EIA process becomes a scapegoat for this blame. But if you really look at the rejection rate of projects under the EIA process, it's only about 2% of projects that are actually rejected. All the other 98 projects, 98% of the projects are approved and they become better projects as a result of the EIA process. So the main purpose of EIA is not the approval or rejection of projects, but to ensure that projects which are proposed go ahead with minimum damage to the environment. So this is the main purpose of an EIA. So EIA is not to make the CEA happy or anybody happy, but to look at what are the actual environment impacts of a project and take proper action to minimize those environmental issues. I don't think I need to go through all this. So when we look at the mitigation of impacts, we cannot and should not take the stand that we have to accept that all 100% of impacts from a project simply cannot be mitigated. So you can't really expect all impacts of a project to be mitigated. And we can't expect the EIA report to study every single impact from a project either. So this is what happens in Sri Lanka. The people who write the EIA reports, they write and write and write. They write about every single impact that comes from a project. Actually, that is not the idea of a EIA report. The EIA report should only study the impacts which are major impacts. Major impacts and how you are going to mitigate them. So there is no need to do a impact analysis of every single impact. So this is what we do in what we call scoping. Before we do the environmental impact assessment, we do something called scoping exercise, and in that exercise only you decide what are the major impacts of a project and what is the CIA report going to focus on, what are these issues. So based on that only the terms of reference for an environmental impact assessment is normally drawn. So I don't think I'll go through all these problems of EIA reports, but I'll come to the conclusion. So the EIA process is meant to assist in the decision making process, and they are not meant to confuse decision makers with unnecessary details, but it should give a clear and concise analysis of the project impacts on the environment and the extent to which they could be mitigated, and also the impacts that cannot be mitigated. So if there are some impacts that cannot be mitigated, the environmental impact assessment report must mention it. Without, what people do is they just get a hold of a book or the internet and just write pages and pages and pages from internet or some book. So that is not what you need in an environmental impact assessment. You have to say exactly, if you are doing a power project, you have to say how, in actual fact, how you are going to mitigate the sulfur dioxide emissions. Or if there is hazardous waste coming out of a project, how are you going to deal with this hazardous waste? So there is no point writing something that is in the internet or in a book. It has to be something that the project proponent is actually going to implement. So it has to be a basically a realistic report. So this is now about planning of projects. Now since you are engineers involved in project planning should look into environmental aspects during the planning stage. This is what I was telling earlier. There's no point looking at the environmental issues after your design and everything is over, right? During the feasibility and planning stage, issues such as loss of forest cover and impacts on wildlife should be considered in addition to engineering aspects. Now, these issues obviously can't be determined by you, because as engineers you don't know whether it's a forest or a wildlife. So this is why we say you have to talk to the other agencies concerned. Like for example, if you are designing an irrigation project, most of the time it will take up some forest land or wildlife areas. So in which case you have to talk to the forest department and the wildlife department at the beginning of, even before you start designing the project. Because if you design the project without talking to them, at the end of your design they will come and say, no, you can't do this. Then you have to sit and redraft the whole thing from the beginning. So if you talk to them at the early stages itself, you will save yourself a lot of trouble, because I have seen this happening a lot of times. Now there are many irrigation and water supply projects planned, especially in the north, you find, right? These are very useful projects. So no one is saying not to do those projects, as they provide irrigation as well as drinking water to areas which were deprived of water in the past, right? So during the project planning and feasibility stage, it's very important for the engineering professionals to have close consultation and discussions with conservation agencies such as the Forest Department, Wildlife Department, in order to address the issues they may have. So a lot of projects have stopped halfway because of the Forest Department and Wildlife Department. So for that you can't blame the Forest Department and the Wildlife Department, but you have to blame the people who designed that irrigation project, because Forest Department, their duty is to protect the forest. And if you take the Wildlife Department, their duty is to protect the wildlife. So you have to understand that it is their duty to protect the wildlife, just like it's your duty or whoever's duty to provide irrigation water to some areas. So this is why it's very important that you talk to these people at the beginning of designing of a project. In many projects in Sri Lanka, agencies such as the Forest Department and Department of Wildlife Conservation get to know about the projects only at the EIA stage. So only at this stage, the Forest Department and Wildlife Department is called in when they come to the EIA stage. Then only they look up and say, oh, we didn't know that there was such a project. So this is too late in the project cycle, and because of this, many projects get late to be implemented. So now I'm going to start. I have to be somewhere at leave at 6 o'clock. If you have any questions, take the next 10 minutes to answer any questions or comments or anything. Or any other issues on environment which I haven't covered even, doesn't matter. Any questions? No questions. How many of you have been involved in EIS? Where do you all work? I mean, are you all working in government agencies or private sector? How many in the private sector? Most of you are in the private sector. Government sector? Almost half, no? Where are you from? Irrigation? Anyone from the irrigation department? You are from the irrigation department. This problem I was talking about, you all have, no, all the time with the forest department and the wildlife department? So any questions? No. Comments? Why don't I say something? I can't talk anymore anyway. No comments, no nothing. You can't just listen to a lecturer and this is not the university that or school. I mean, you all must argue with us, and I mean, do you have anything against the environmental, because a lot of times engineers don't like environmental regulation, that I know. So how do you all find you find environmental regulation the problem? Even in single, even you can tell whatever you want. Yeah. Only thing, I don't know Tamil. Huh? Yes. No, for the project not to go ahead.
Yeah. So,
But no, now it can go the other way also, no? Now they can, the project, the EIA is written by consultants who are hired by the company or whoever is doing the EIA, no? I mean, the, who is doing the project, no? So it can go both ways, no? They can say this project can go ahead even if it is a bad project, no? So how you deal with that is there is a technical evaluation committee, no? So you have experts in that committee, in the technical evaluation committee. So you can't just write whatever you want in the report. For example, if you take air pollution, if the environmentalist says there is a lot of pollution when there isn't pollution, then the other expert will point it out, no, whoever is in the tech committee. Or if they say when there is pollution, if they say there is no pollution, which happens most of the time, you know, they try to just gloss over something, you know, they show that there is no issue at all, and there is an issue. So that can happen, that is what happens most of the time. And then also the tech member will always raise that issue. So you can't just get away by just writing something, which they do, or they'll copy from some other EIA report. They do that all the time, they cut and paste from some other report. They don't really study the actual facts of that project. So that problem is there. So that is why you have a technical evaluation committee consisting of experts who can, you know, find out those issues. I can't hear what? Yeah. Ask him for? From whom? Yes. Yes.
You are thinking that EIA is not how is that protected? If you go and ask from other agencies?
No, now in the technical evaluation of the other agencies are always there. Like the forest department is usually there. If they have any, you know, if it is, if it concerns some forest area or something, in the tech committee, always the forest department and wildlife are there. So you don't have to go again to them, but they are in that committee. So if they have any issues, they will bring those up. So this is why I say in many projects, these issues of forest land and wildlife areas are brought up at this tech committee. Then only they know that it's a forest conservation forest or wildlife area or something. Before that, the project person who is doing the project doesn't really look at those issues. And then it's too late really. Then the project gets delayed by several months and sometimes years even. So it's a very big problem, especially irrigation department. I know so many projects have got delayed because of this issue. And some of them have got stopped also. So that is an issue. Any other comments? Yeah.
I have one question.
Yes.
Say that we have a certain project, project A,
yes.
And initially we do EIA and get approval.
Yes.
It's actually there.
Yeah.
So there can be a certain situation where project A has to be extended or an extension for project A.
Yeah. Now extension means. You mean expand it?
Yeah,
expand. Yes, yes.
So, in that particular expansion, there can be some sort of environmentally disturbing some kind of things in.
Yeah.
So, will there be any kind of monitoring from the.
Generally, all these projects are supposed to be monitored. Okay. And. So
will there be some kind of a continuous monitoring?
Continuous monitoring, if it's a very major project, there'll be regular monitoring, not continuous, every day they can't go, no, they don't have enough officers to go around. But if it's a very major project, yes, there is monitoring. So if just now, like what you said, if you are going to have got approval for a certain project and you are expanding the project, then you have to get another approval for that expansion actually. That first approval says that in the approval conditions, If you are going to make any changes to the project, you have to get another. Now you don't have to go through a EIA again, but for that additional part, you have to get approval. That's all. You don't have, may not have to do another EIA or anything. Yeah, conditional approval. Always that condition is there in that letter. That problem is, most of the people don't read that letter. So they never read that letter, so they don't know that there is such a condition.
Yes,
people do that all the time. Because then only after some time either CEO or somebody finds out, then they get into trouble really, because that project, that part of the project is not approved now. So if there's a court case or something, then they are in very serious trouble. Because the court will always ask the CEO to come, and they will ask, has this person got this approval for this additional part? Then if the CEO says no, then it's an unauthorized kind of thing, and the courts can tell you to close down that part. That part of the whole thing even. That happens sometimes.
So as for the saying, only if that particular expansion get caught by some legal body,
yes,
then only the authority will act about it.
Oh. Yeah, if they don't know about it, they can't act, no? I mean, yeah, so sometimes when people go to do monitoring, they find that they have expanded from the original project. They go for monitoring, no? So some of these projects, after the EIA, they have to get what is called the environmental life, say if it's a big industry or something. Now after the first EIA approval, they have to get a license every year for industries. So a lot of times what you say happens, they go to on the inspection, because the people, before they renew the license, they go on inspection. And when they go on the inspection, they find that the person has expanded the industry or whatever. Then they get into trouble. Yeah, because things like industries, they monitor now. Now things like highway or something, once the EIA approval is given, they don't have to be monitoring a highway every day, no? So they won't monitor it like that. But if it's a large scale industry or something, they will monitor. So there is a high possibility that they will find out in a situation like that. So any other questions? 6 o'clock, so I have to go anyway. Okay, then thank you very much.